لا إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، ما بعد. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Today's حلقة is dedicated to أم الحدى مريم عبيد. Allah yarhamuha, who passed away this Friday, a grand day of Dhul-Hijjah, a Friday of Dhul-Hijjah, mashallah. She passed away just after the Jum'ah prayer in Damascus. Daughter of Ghassan Ubaid, who is a descendant of Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu an, the great Ansar of Medina. And this is something that all of us who knew Umm al-Huda, Maryam, mashallah, rahmatullah alayha, she was clearly one of the Ansar, because this is what her forte was. She loved to serve the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam. And as we'll see, this is the peak of her life was in doing so, mashallah. I just wanted to take some wisdom from Sheikh Abul Hassan Ash-Shadhani himself, and perhaps some words from Sheikh Al-Akbar, because these times, anytime something happens in the Ummah, of course it should affect all of us, and I think that's what we're feeling here for us, having seen Sheikh Muhammad and his family endure the passing of his first wife Umm Ibrahim rahmatullah alayha, and then none of us would have thought that we'd be giving condolences to him again. But that is the case, and mashallah, we have to observe Sheikh Muhammad and his demeanor in order to learn what really true patience is. In fact, both his wives and Sheikh Muhammad himself, hafidhahu Allah, may Allah protect and preserve him and his family, they exhibit this quality of sabrun jamilun, this beautiful patience, and everyone who's in Damascus can attest to that. In fact, I should say that look out for Sheikh Saeed Ramadan al-Buti's tribute to her. He's going to write one up in Damascus, and inshallah, I'm sure one of the brethren will translate it. And also Sheikh Hassan al-Hindi, two great scholars from Damascus, will be writing their own, they'll be penning their own words about Umm al-Huda, rahmatullah alayha. They've already spoken some words about her. In fact, when Sheikh Saeed Ramadan al-Buti spoke, giving condolences to Sheikh Muhammad, he kept mentioning Umm al-Huda and him, and all of praises, because he knew her family from when she was young, and we'll get into that in a bit. But Sheikh Abul Hassan al-Shadhili radiallahu anhu, he said that anything that we go through, there's only two states we have we're experiencing, faqad or wajid. We're experiencing a loss or we're getting a gain. So either we have to have a state of gratitude or we have a state of acquiescence of that thing that we are finding a deficiency in, faqad. So, but the awliya, they're praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in both those states, whether they're gaining or they're, in the dunyawi terms, losing. There really is no such thing as losing, as we know, for a believer. But what the in the dunyawi perspective, what people would call a loss, they're constantly in gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, I was going to mention this at the end, but it applies here. Sheikh Saeed Ramadan al-Buti actually told Sheikh Muhammad, when he came to give him his condolence, he said, I offer you congratulation. I'm not offering you a condolence. So meaning that he knows that through these trials, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is raising the rank of Sheikh Muhammad al-Yaqubi, hafidhahu Allah. So, and this is what all of the ulama have been saying to him, that they clearly see this as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raising his rank through these trials. And it's immense. And another Actually, if we look at the word sabr, which we all know very well, even if we don't speak Arabic, the root word has the meaning of to bind or to tie up or to be enshackled. Sabara yasbiru. And another form, sabara, means to ballast, to put the heavy weights on a boat to anchor it. So when you think about the word, we can get the real meaning here when we look at some of these root letter meanings. In fact, musabarat means canned goods. So you see the meaning there's reserves, having some reserves for a time when you need it. So this is what the awliya, they always have a supply because they're always doing dhikr. They're either doing dhikr of the tongue or doing some other ibadah. Everything has become an ibadah for them, which is available to all of us, inshallah, to have our whole life be an ibadah, to make worship. That's what a Muslim has, mashallah. And so when you look at the root meaning there, this is why you don't catch the awliya or the ulama off guard. They're deeply rooted into the akhirah. So for us, the commoner, we have times, as Sheikh Shadhili says, we experience faqd and wajd. So, and as we know, the commoner doesn't experience much loss because we wouldn't be able to bear it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in His wisdom, gives the calamities to the awliya. I mean, the first of all is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. No one has ever experienced what they have experienced, alayhi salatu wasalam. And then next come the men and women of Allah, the awliya, the arifin, and so on. So that this is out of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy that we don't experience the punishments of the sins. It's like a physical law, just like we know fire burns, we have physical laws, but we have the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we may not recognize, but these are unseen laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that are applied on the earth. So anytime someone commits a sin, there's a certain a calamity, a trial that has to befall on the earth as the law that is set into place already on the earth. But out of His mercy, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that test is placed on the shoulders of those who can bear it, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promises that He doesn't bear any soul more than what it can bear. So this is out of His mercy. And this is another way to look at we don't want real justice, because we always, in the dunyawi realm, this is what we talk about, there should be justice. But if you look at it from this perspective, I don't think anyone would ask for justice. We want Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's mercy, because then it's put in the right place. So the awliya are deeply rooted in al-Jannah. So anytime a calamity befalls, they're able to handle it. We talked a couple of halaqas ago about a deeply rooted tree, like the banyan tree, and how strong it is. No matter how forceful the winds are, it will remain, it will bend with the wind, but it won't break. Whereas a twig, a stiff, dry twig, will break even with the slightest wind. So we need to have that flexibility, and this is where it comes from. When we have reserves of sabr, and that comes from reserves of ibadah. So one who is connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who has been working on being connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at other times of trial, will be deeply rooted, inshallah, and will be able to bend and be flexible with that trial and gain more closeness, inshallah. So these are the secrets of the awliya, and this is how they handle it in terms of the real breakdown. And actually, the word wali, singular of awliya, Shaykh al-Akbar said, the real meaning of wali is the last two letters of wali, the last part of it, meaning li. It means that a friend, it's translated as a saint or a friend of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, but that really doesn't capture the meaning of wali. And Shaykh al-Akbar's translation here, his explanation works much better, that li meaning mine. So a wali means this is someone Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala possesses, someone that he has brought close to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why we see their composure and their demeanor at such a high level, because they're deeply rooted in the akhirah. We have, as commoners, veils between us, but they see the akhirah right before them. So they're able to handle all of these things, mashallah, with that stance, that deep rootedness. And like we said, the Tai Chi, the Tai Chi champion, this is the exact word that he uses when a really good martial artist, he will describe to his students how he does he get that stance by having as if there's roots going beneath his feet so that the opponent can't surprise him, can't shock him, can't throw him off guard. And these are the tricks that they use. So in the spiritual realm, this is what we have to have happening, and this is the secret. And just knowing this one aspect of the spiritual realm of Islam would get us through everything. We wouldn't have this hyperbolic state that some cultures are more known for. I can say that the Desi culture is, since I'm from the Desi culture, we tend to react. Alhamdulillah, actually, many have improved since we're learning the hadith and understanding the seerah and how the Sahaba radiallahu anhum lived and how all these calamities and trials that we think are great, they pale in comparison to our predecessors, to the Salaf. So moving on then, mentioning the Salaf radiallahu anhum, Sheikh Sa'id actually, he said, Maryam rahmatullah alayha, she is of a time like our predecessors, the Salaf radiallahu anhum. She didn't belong to this time. And I think many of us that saw her can attest to that. She was not of this time because she didn't react to the things of the dunya or the happenings around as we do. It's as if she lived in that previous time of purity and tranquility in her kindness. And well, first let's start with her upbringing. So because that's where it started. Where did her character develop? So she is one of three sisters. She has three other sisters, I should say. And as we said, a descendant of Sayyidina Anas radiallahu an, her mother was Spanish. Her mother is Spanish and her father is Syrian. And so she was brought up in this very righteous household. And actually, she had been studying at the Ma'had al-Fath, a very well-known institute in Damascus for Islamic higher learning. But what happened is at the age of 14, she was diagnosed with leukemia. And so she had to stop her studies at the Ma'had. And what happened afterwards is that she was given many years of treatment, both in Syria and in America. And miraculously, she recovered much of it from the du'as of Sheikh Saeed Ramadan al-Bouti. MashaAllah, he had made du'a for her. And so the family considered it a great miracle after his du'a that they said that she was free from the leukemia. Now, those of us have been around her know that this, doesn't mean that she was fully healthy. I mean, her immunity was weakened. We all know that. Those of us who have, been around her through the years, the last couple of years that Sheikh Mohammed has been married to her. Just over 2.5 years he's been married to her. Allah yarhamuha. So this was her upbringing, a very righteous household. In fact, Sheikh Mohammed knew her father long before he proposed to her. Her father, Ghassan Ubaid, he used to attend Sheikh Ibrahim radiallahu anhu, his lectures. And then later Maryam's father started attending Sheikh Mohammed's lectures as well. And he remembers Sheikh Mohammed crawling behind him in Jami al-Kuwaiti. So they have a relationship from years ago, mashallah. And Maryam, Allah yarhamuha, she had, before she even knew about Sheikh Mohammed's proposal, she had seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in a dream showing, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was showing her Sheikh Mohammed, that this would be her husband, mashallah. A little bit about what she so she as I said, she was studying the deen before she was diagnosed with the leukemia, and then alhamdulillah, that was in remission. But then many may not know this, but she was previously married, and at the time that this a few years before Sheikh Mohammed finally married her, but she was married to a man who didn't treat her well. She was physically abused and not treated well at all. And I remember when Sheikh Mohammed first found out about her was through his good friend the Mardinis, Abdurrahman Mardini. And they had asked him for dua. He didn't know her about her at all. Like I said, her father knew Sheikh Mohammed, so and knew the family very well, but he didn't know about this daughter of his and what trial she was facing. So anyway, the Mardini family requested Sheikh Mohammed do a dua for her, that because what happened is she couldn't take this man as her husband anymore. He was abusing her very. Just very, very, just horrible things to her. So she escaped, and then after she escaped from that house, for 2 years he would not grant her the divorce. And so the family asked Sheikh Mohammed for the dua, and the next day the divorce was given in court. And Maryam, Allah yarhamha, was very proud of this fact later on after she married Sheikh Mohammed, when she found out that this was the Sheikh that made dua for you. Of course, as I said, Sheikh Mohammed had not met her at that time, had not ever met her before he married her. So, though he knew her father, mashallah. So she was very proud of this fact. And Sheikh Mohammed himself saw clear signals. I mean, I remember when the subject of Maryam first came up, I was at the Hajj with Sheikh Mohammed, and he had told myself and a small group of us that. He told us about Maryam, Allah yarhamuha, and that he saw clear signals that he should marry her. And this was out of the blue. I mean, there was no indication that he wanted to get married. He was very happy with Ibrahim, rahmatullah alayha, at that time. But because he got this very strong signal while he was performing the Hajj, it so happened that right when he got back to Damascus, and her father found out that Sheikh Mohammed. Mentioned this to someone at Hajj. He called Sheikh Mohammed and said, "What are you waiting for? Go ahead and propose to my daughter." And so it happened that way, mashallah. And alhamdulillah, soon after their marriage, Sheikh Mohammed was able to take her on a whirlwind tour, because he happened to be going first to America, is where they actually had their wedding party in America, though the contract was signed in Damascus. He hadn't met her yet, and then she was in California at the time. That's when he finally met her in California. And I remember those days where he was, I think we all remember that, he was so ecstatic and a real newlywed, mashallah. So after having their party in America, then she went on this whirlwind tour with Sheikh Mohammed to Cairo, and visited Sheikh Abul Hassan, rahimallah, and Imam Busiri and other awliya while she was there in Egypt. And then they also went to Medina that year. The rihla was taking place, where Sheikh Mohammed did the Shama'il. So, and this is where a lot of people did meet her, the students that did get to know Huda Maryam, Allah yarhamuha, mashallah, because she was able to go on this whirlwind trip. And who would have known? I remember Sheikh Mohammed was very particular about everything because of her being newlywed, and knowing at that point, I don't think anyone else knew about her background and what had the trials she had already faced in her young life. He wanted everything perfect for the wedding, and so we did our part to try to do what we could about that. And they were so happy when the visas came through to go to Al Madina. And alhamdulillah, she's very proud of the fact that she was able to stand at the Rawda Al Sharif with Sheikh Mohammed and no one else there, just her husband, Sheikh Mohammed, and herself at the shrine for quite some time in the middle of the night. Sheikh Mohammed stood with her, and of course, they made a lot of dua together there. So this was one of the highlights of her marriage, those days. So it's so amazing, because at that time, I remember Sheikh Mohammed wanting everything, I mean, going everything through everything meticulously, as is his nature, but especially so because of he wanted to kind of have all of this make up for her trials of the past, what he, her time with him, mashallah. So now looking back, I get, subhanAllah, everything that a wali does, there's reason for it. Because I remember one time I was neglectful of one particular thing in terms of a ride or something, and I remember he did tell me he wanted everything to be perfect for her, mashallah. So all of this comes into place now when you realize that the awliya, everything they say, there's a reason. I mean, they're reacting from the unseen, mashallah. So she did have, I mean, this, you could say this is actually an incredible story of happiness and joy and triumph. It's not a sad story, because if you know what her life was like beforehand and these last couple of years with Sheikh Mohammed, this was, she was a queen. She was living a queen life, mashallah. Everything that she wanted to do, she got in these last couple of years with Sheikh Mohammed. And in fact, I mean, we all saw that nothing made her happier than serving Sheikh Mohammed, because she was living the role of an Ansari woman by doing for the Ahlul Bayt. And really, like you saw, this immense pride and satisfaction and glow on her face. She would actually get upset if Sheikh Mohammed went to get a cup of water by himself. She wouldn't like that, because she said, "What am I here for?" So, mashallah, her adab, and everyone is a witness to her etiquette around Sheikh Mohammed and everyone else. I mean, there isn't a soul that she didn't love. She had no reason not to love. Just anyone she met, she would be perfectly, just with finesse, she would relate with everyone. There was no strings attached with her love. You could feel it. She didn't have to say much, by the way. Unlike Sheikh Mohammed's first wife, mashallah, we knew her love because she said so. But Maryam Umul Huda, contrary wise, we knew her love because it exuded from her. She didn't have to say a word, but you just felt comfortable and very easy and at ease around her. Not like the stiff kind of feeling where someone, if someone doesn't talk, you feel uncomfortable. It was the opposite feeling where, and she was the epitome of practicing samt, having that silence, so that you could see that she was from another world, because she was remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I mean, we all saw that dhikr, remembrance of Allah, was on her tongue constantly. And Sheikh Mohammed attested to also her qiyam al-layl, just like Ibrahim. Allah yarhamuhuma, both of them were known for their nightly vigils, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in Maryam's case, of course, it's even more spectacular, knowing that her physical limitations and the weakness that she did have from asthma and infections every now and then, as I said, from having a low immunity, though the leukemia was in remission. So, mashallah, Sheikh Mohammed did say that you couldn't have asked for more in a wife, in any way, in any adjective that you look at, in terms of beauty, in elegance, in kindness, in devotion. He was just extremely happy with her, and she was happy with him. And she had said that there's nothing else that she loved more in the world than Sheikh Mohammed, and he said the same of her, that there's nothing that he loves more than her. And he actually, Sheikh Mohammed said, to qualify that, because some people don't understand when an alim is saying that he's heartbroken to lose his beloved. Some people misconstrue that and say, well, shouldn't he, have this constancy? Of course, they still have a love, but there, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam said, that it's only the reaction from the hands or the mouth that is disliked, but from the heart and the eyes, when a loved one passes, then this is natural for a human being. And of course, the awliya experience this kind of sadness. But as I said, Sheikh Ramadan Bhutti gave him congratulations rather than a condolence, because he knows that he, first of all, that he can handle this, that Sheikh Mohammed takes this as another test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, inshallah, it's for elevation, bi-idhnillah. And all that means is for all of us too, that anytime, whatever we're facing, we have this sabr that we talked about at the outset, that we shackle our hands, the limbs that are not supposed to have a reaction, if we want to follow a higher a calling, which is closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we have this kind of patience, a beautiful patience, in remembering that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. inshallah. So I had to give that caveat because he himself said so. Some people can misconstrue that. I mean, either way you look at it, people criticize the awliya. Some would say, oh, they're even when some calamity happens in their family, they're indifferent. Like I talked about years ago, about Sheikh Ibrahim, radiallahu anhu, how when one of his infant newborn died and he had a session going on, even though earlier in the morning the baby had already died, but he was rocking the baby in the bassinet as if nothing had happened, so that the class would not be disturbed, and didn't tell the class until the end of the session and said, let's go bury the baby now. And so Sheikh Muhammad, actually Friday, he did deliver a lecture. Some of you know his usual time slot, Friday. He gave his usual lecture and didn't announce the passing of his wife till the end of that lecture, mashallah. In following suit in his father's footsteps. In fact, though, Sheikh Mohammed would, during these last couple of years, during these last few years, the only time you would see him cancel a class is if Maryam, Umul Huda, Allah yarhamuha, was sick. And this was because of his devotion to her. And he would serve her in bed when she was sick, and in addition to taking care of the kids. Which brings me to the other point about Umul Huda, Allah yarhamuha, having gone through the passing of Sheikh Muhammad's first wife after a year of their marriage. She was there when he lost his first wife, and all of a sudden became the stepmother to his three young children, all under 10 at this point in time. So, and she, at the beginning, it was she hadn't met them, so she had to grow into it. But I can attest to the fact that it was subhanAllah, she had become such a graceful, delicate, loving mother to them. And I haven't seen the kids that happy since I just saw them this past summer, in their devotion to her and calling her mama. I mean, they went gradually first, say, I think they called her Khala Maryam, Aunt Maryam. Then they progressed to, and this is all on their own, they started calling her Mama Maryam. And then recently they just called her Mama whenever they needed her. So they had really grown in their love for her, mashallah. And what we can say, inshallah, she has what we all make dua for, which is Husnul Khatima. Inshallah, she had that famous dua about how we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the best of our days the latter portion of our days. And this is what Maryam, Umul Huda, Allah yarhamuha, experienced as I just went through. She was able to live that. And this is all the ulama make dua for, that their best days are the latter part of their days, that their best works are also the ceiling of their works, and the best day, the day they meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So she did attain the two parts of that dua, that supplication we do. Inshallah, she will attain the third and meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, her Lord, without account. Inshallah, may we reunite with her at Al-Hawd, the pool of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. I mean, there's much more that can be said about Sheikh Muhammad's love for her. And she also, by the way, loved Sheikh Ibrahim radiallahu anhu immensely. And this is why Sheikh Muhammad, and in fact, she had asked for it, if anything happened to her, that she would like to be buried next to Sheikh Ibrahim, Sheikh Muhammad's father. May Allah have mercy on him. So she did get that wish as well, mashallah. And if you look at it, Sheikh Muhammad buried his first wife, Ibrahim, rahmatullah alayha, close to next to his mother. And now Maryam Umul Huda is buried next to his father, which is a telltale of his of the amount of love he had for each. We all know that his love for his father is immense, and of course he has that incredible love for his mother. So this is a clue that he loved Umul Huda, Maryam, more. I mean, anytime you have a husband who marries more than one, I had asked a bunch of men about this one time, like, would there always be a natural